It's a pleasant good morning to you all once again. So once again, I'm very happy to welcome you all for the second session of this FDP. So on behalf of all the participants present here, I'm very much pleased to welcome Professor Katta Venkatramana, Professor Department of Civil Engineering, NIT Karnataka, Suratkal. So may I now invite Ms. Ruby Freya, co-coordinator of this FDP program, to introduce Professor Katta Venkatramana to the audience.
Thank you, ma'am. So it's my pleasure to welcome our guest. So Professor Katta Venkatramana is a senior professor at the Department of Civil Engineering, National Institute of Technology, Karnataka, Suratkal. He obtained his bachelor's degree in civil engineering from University of Mysore, master's degree from Kagoshima University, Japan, and doctorate from Kyoto University, Japan. He has worked as a postdoctoral research fellow at University of Oxford, UK. He is serving NITK Suratkal as a professor since 2002. He has served as the HOD of civil engineering at NITK two times during 2009 to 10 and 13 to 14. He was the Dean Academics and the Chairman of Board of Studies at NITK for 3 years from 2014 to 2017. Sir's current research interests include structural engineering, structural dynamics, and earthquake engineering. He has supervised a large number of undergraduate and postgraduate students in their thesis research. 19 PhD scholars have completed their PhD degree under his guidance. Professor has delivered many invited talks in India and abroad. He was a visiting professor at Kumamoto University, Japan during 2010 to 11. He is a fellow of Institution of Engineers India, and currently he is serving as the chairman of Institution of Engineers India, Mangalore Local Center. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, madam, for the introduction. Shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Okay. I am thankful to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to deliver this presentation. I'll be speaking about the engineering seismology, basic aspects of seismology, and also lessons from some of the past earthquakes. Just we'll quickly go through how the earthquakes are generated, how earthquakes are measured, and then what are the effects of these earthquakes on buildings. So first, the definition of earthquake, you all know. Vibrations of the earth's surface caused by waves originating from a source of disturbance in the earth mass is called earthquake. Earthquake may be caused by volcanic eruption or by strain building process inside the earth mass. So in the left-hand side, you can see the cross-section of the earth. We have the core, inner core, outer core, then mantle, lower mantle, upper mantle, and then crust. If you look at the temperature, inner core, it is around 4,300 degrees centigrade, which reduces to 3,700 degrees centigrade at the outer edge of the core. And then we have the mantle temperature ranging from 3,700 degrees to 1,000 degrees centigrade. And crust, we have the atmospheric temperature. Because of this temperature gradient and pressure gradients, there will be a movement inside the mantle, as you can see in this central figure. It is something like what happens when you heat the water in a beaker. Water, when it gets heated, moves upwards, cools down, and then goes inside. Same thing is happening here in the Earth's interior. Similar thing is happening. And we have the formation of ridges, volcanoes, where the this molten molten element is pushing out. And then also we have the pulling of slabs along the surface, and then formation of the trenches. So the earthquake may be caused by volcanic eruption or by strain building process inside the atmas. The main thing is it is very much unpredictable. We cannot say when earthquakes occur, but the probability of occurrence of earthquakes where there are history of past earthquakes is large. So here the plate tectonics is explained in this slide. Earth's surface is consists of several plates of a more fluid zone,
Professor, your mic is muted.
Sir, you are not audible.
Sir, in the G Meet, you can just click on the mic button, sir. The Google Meet itself.
Sir, you are muted.
Yeah. Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, 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 Professor.
Yes.
You are not yet able to see my presentation. No?
Yes, sir.
I think I will start once again. You could not hear from the beginning. Okay, are you able to see the presentation?
Yes, yes, Professor, we are seeing the presentation.
Okay, 1 minute, I will make it PPT mode.
Now it is in slide. Are you able to see?
But it's not in the slideshow now.
Now in the slideshow mode, I think. Okay. Now, slideshow mode.
No, Professor, it is not in the slideshow mode.
Here it is in the slideshow mode.
Sir, like before, you can just share the entire screen, sir.
What about now?
Yes, sir. It is now. It is now in the slideshow. Yeah.
Okay. So let me quickly go through this. The definitions of the earthquake: vibrations of the earth's surface caused by waves originating from a source of disturbance in the earth mass is called earthquake. It may be caused by volcanic eruption or by a strain building process inside the earth mass. Highly unpredictable. But the probability of occurrence of earthquakes in the same place where they have occurred in the past is more. Left hand side here we can see cross section of the earth. We have core, inner core, outer core, then mantle, lower mantle, upper mantle, and then earth's crust. If you look at the temperature, inner core consists of solid iron mainly, 4300 degrees centigrade. Outer core, liquid, iron, sulfur, temperature ranging 3700 degrees centigrade. And then mantle, temperature variation reducing up to 1000 degrees centigrade. It is in the plastic stage. And because of the temperature and pressure gradient, we have this movement here. Within the mantle, it is something like when you heat the water in a beaker, the circulations take place. Same thing is happening here, resulting in formation of ridges, pulling slabs, formation of trenches, and so on. And the generation of earthquakes is usually explained using plate tectonic theory. As per this, Earth's surface consists of several rigid plates which float on top of a more fluid zone, much in the way icebergs float on the top of the ocean. We will go through this further. About 225 million years ago, continents were joined into one supercontinent, which Wegener called Pangaea. And with the passage of years, by around 200 million years ago, this Pangaea was divided into two large subcontinents, Laurasia and Gondwanaland. And by 135 million years ago, this is the configuration. In the Great Southern Subcontinent, Gondwanaland, South America, and Africa were connected with each other. You can see this South America, Africa, and this is the Gondwanaland. They were connected with each other, with Antarctica, India, and Australia also. This is roughly the time when the first flowering plants began to appear on Earth. By 65 million years ago, about the time when dinosaurs became extinct, the continents are divided into positions closer to the present-day configuration. This is the present day configuration. So we have these continents: South America, North America, Africa, Asia, Australia, Antarctica, Arctica, and so on. So this animation shows the formation of the continents. So one supercontinent divided into several continents with the passage of time. So Earth's surface here consists of 7 major plates. So Pacific plate, Australian, Indo-Australian plate, North American, South American plate, African plate, Eurasian plate, Antarctic plate. And as the plates move, they pull apart or collide, unleashing earthquakes along their boundaries. We have the formation of mountains, valleys being formed, rift valleys, sea floor spreading, and so on. If you look at the frequency of occurrence of earthquakes, earthquakes, as I mentioned, occur mainly along these plate boundaries, mainly along the boundaries of these plates. And these plates, 7 major plates and several minor ones, they move a few centimeters a year, riding on semi-molten layers of rock underneath the crust. And these circles actually indicate the occurrence of earthquakes. If you look at the data here, very minor earthquakes, mainly recorded by instruments, we have about 13 lakhs in a year. Minor earthquakes, magnitude 3 to 3.9, about 1,30,000. These earthquakes don't cause any damage, but mainly recorded by instruments. We can understand the seismicity of the region if we have this data. Then earthquakes classified as light, 4 to 4.9, around 13,000. Moderate, 5 to 5.9, around 1,319 worldwide in a year. And these are the earthquakes which can cause severe damage. We call strong earthquake magnitude 6 to 6.9, about 134. And major earthquake 7 to 7.9 magnitude, around 17. Whereas at least one earthquake of magnitude 8 and higher is expected to occur in a year. And there are several volcanoes around the Pacific plate. This area is called as Ring of Fire. Ring of Fire. New Zealand, Philippines, Indonesia, then Japan, then here parts of Alaska, then western parts of America, North America, Central America, and South America, like Peru, Chile are here. So all around this Pacific plate, there are many volcanoes. So this area is also known as Ring of Fire. I will show the example of a volcano in Japan. Here we have Philippine plate, Pacific plate, and Eurasian plate converging. So there are a lot of volcanoes in Japan. This one volcano is in this city called Kagoshima, near Kagoshima. This is a mountain, Sakurajima. This is Kagoshima city, population around 5 lakh. Kagoshima Bay separating this volcanic mountain. You can see an eruption happening. Smoke coming out, a night view of this mountain is shown here, where you can see the molten lava coming out from this volcano. So around the Pacific plate, there are several volcanoes, not only in Japan, also in New Zealand, then Chile, and so on. And greatest recorded global earthquakes is shown in this table. So far, magnitude 9.5 happened in Chile in 1960. 9.2 magnitude Alaska, 9.1 Indonesia earthquake 2004. Even India also experienced a lot of damage due to tsunami along the east coast, southern part, and then at Sri Lanka and so on. And this happened in 2004. Then 1952 magnitude 9 earthquake in Russia, and then in Japan. In 2011, an earthquake of magnitude 9 happened. Similarly, Chile, a magnitude 8.8, and so on. So this is some of the severe earthquakes recorded worldwide. Haiti earthquake magnitude was 7.1, but it is a poor country with a lot of unengineered construction. More than 2 lakh people died during this earthquake. Now, coming to our Indian plate. Indian plate, this is the position 71 million years ago. It has moved northwards and collided with the Asian Eurasian plate. So, it is indicates the position of Indian plate in various years. So, this is the present location. So, Himalayas were formed because of the collision of Indian plate with the Eurasian plate. India makes contact with southern margin of Asia about 55 million years ago. And this shows the geographical layout and tectonic plate boundaries. This is the tectonic plate boundaries. And we have most of the earthquakes occurring along these boundaries, tectonic plate. Now, this shows the birth of Himalayas. As I said, because of the collision of Indian plate with the Eurasian plate, Himalayas were formed. 60 million years ago, there was sea, a Death Sea. India collides into the Asian plate. This movement is what eventually causes the Himalayan range. As the two plates push against each other and the Earth's crust is squeezed upwards. So this Indian plate, this is the Asian plate, Eurasian plate. So they are pushing against each other. So these sediments are pushed upwards. So this 60 million years ago, then 40 million years ago, if you see heavy sediments on the ocean floor sink under the Asian plate, slowly closing up the Tethys Sea. You can see the sea has narrowed here and we have the sediments at here ground level. And Indian plate is colliding even deeper into Tibet. So mountains have started forming here. 20 million years ago. So the sea is completely gone and heavy sediments from the ocean floor are pushed up to form the Himalayas and Tibet also begins to rise. This is today's scenario. Through GPS technology, we know that 19 kilometers below the surface of the Earth, India continent to move northwards under Tibet at 18 mm per year. The greater Himalaya, including Everest, are rising at approximately 5 mm per year as a result of this squeezing motion between India and Tibet. So, Himalayas are rising approximately 5 mm per year. So 20 million years ago already sea is completely gone and presently still plate movement is there. Himalayas are rising and it is predicted that 10 million years from now, as the boundaries of Nepal approach each other, Nepal ceases to exist. The Himalaya, however, still exists as foothills and mountains continue to form over the advancing edge of the Asia, edge of India. So if you look here, the boundaries of Nepal which are existing today, it is predicted that 10 million years ago, they approach each other. Nepal boundaries approach each other, and Himalayas will be still there, and mountains continuing to rise. So, because of this movement, we have this tectonic plate boundary, and we have the most of the earthquakes along these boundaries. This shows the year. This is Bhuj earthquake. This is not 2002. This 2001 actually. Then all these years actually indicate the occurrence of major earthquakes along this plate boundary. We'll discuss some of these earthquakes in the later part of our discussion. This shows the seismicity of India from 1973 to present. These red circles indicate the earthquake. Most of the earthquakes occur along the plate boundaries, but we also have earthquakes away from the plate boundaries, which we call intraplate earthquakes. Intraplate earthquakes, and they occur mainly along the close to the fault lines. So if you look at the tectonic map of India, this is the thrust boundary, this black line, and we have these fault zones at various locations, and some of the earthquakes have occurred along near these fault zones. So earlier we discussed the largest earthquakes worldwide. Now coming to our country, largest Indian earthquakes. 1618, there is a record of earthquake in Bombay. We are not sure about the magnitude, but around 2000 lives lost. 1720, an earthquake of magnitude 6.5 near Delhi. And 1737, more than 3 lakh people lost their lives in Bengal, earthquake in Bengal. Then 1899 in Gujarat, Kutch region, we had an earthquake of magnitude 8. Similarly, 1833 in Bihar, magnitude 7.7. And Northeast is highly seismic region. Assam in 1869, there was an earthquake of magnitude 7.5. And 1897 in Shillong, magnitude 8.7. This is intensity. Earthquakes can be measured in terms of magnitude, which depend on the amount of energy released, and then based on the damage observed. So whatever data we have has been entered here. 1905, Himachal Pradesh, magnitude 8 earthquake. And again 1906, magnitude 7 earthquake has occurred. So these are some of the past earthquakes. Bihar Nepal earthquake in 1934. Lot of people died here, lot of damage occurred, magnitude 8.3 earthquake. Then some of the recent earthquakes are listed here. 2015 Nepal earthquake, 2011 Sikkim earthquake has happened, and 2004, this is same Indonesia earthquake, damage occurred in India also. Then 2001 January 26 Bhuj earthquake. 1999, there was a severe earthquake in Uttarakhand, magnitude 6.8, and so on. Then 1993 Latur earthquake, Maharashtra, northern part of Karnataka also suffered lot of damage by this earthquake. And 1967, you may be knowing this Koyna earthquake in Maharashtra, magnitude 6.5. And during this earthquake, it is said that after the construction of Koyna Dam, because of the water pressure induced in the fissures, this earthquake happened. So it is a reservoir induced earthquake. So these are some of the earthquakes which occurred in India. We'll quickly go through the terminologies. Where the earthquake energy is released, we call focus. The point on the fault where slip starts is called focus or hypocenter. And the point vertically above, we call epicenter. So this is epicenter, point vertically above the focus and on the surface of the earth. Normally in the newspaper, they will say, where was the epicenter? Then this depth we call focal depth, from hypocenter or from focus to epicenter. Smaller the focal depth, the shaking will be more, damage will be more. And the distance to a point of reference, we call epicentral distance. So we have basic terminology here, focus or hypocenter, epicenter, focal depth, and epicentral distance. Now we will quickly discuss the seismic waves or earthquake waves. So this is the focus or hypocenter. From here we have the waves which are generated due to the release of energy. We have body waves which travel within the earth, and the waves that travel along the surface of the earth we call surface waves. Body waves or deep waves are further classified as P wave or primary wave and S wave, shear wave or secondary waves. In the primary wave, particle motion is along the wave propagation direction. You can see here, right hand side. So push and pull happens here. So extension and compression. Whereas S waves, particle motion is side to side or up and down. Side to side or up and down. And then along the surface, we have Rayleigh waves, where the particle motion is sideways in horizontal plane. And then, Love waves, where the particle motion is sideways along the horizontal plane. Then we have Rayleigh waves, where the particle motion is elliptical. Particle motion is elliptical. So body waves or deep waves are further classified P waves and S waves, and surface waves, Love waves and Rayleigh waves, depending on the particle motion. Among these waves, primary waves travel fastest, followed by S waves and then the surface waves. And these waves, when they pass through soil, they get magnified. They get affected. You see, this is the fault structure or the focus starting. So body waves travel within the earth's interior, and then they reach the surface, travel along the surface also. And these waves further get modified when they pass through soft soil. This is shown here also, right hand side diagram, hard and soft ground. So this is hard ground. And when the waves reach the soft ground, soft soil, they get magnified. So the structures which are located in soft soil, they are vibrated more. So we can expect more damage in these locations. So in such cases, either we have to take preventive measures to deal with the soft soil, or provide pile foundation reaching up to the hard ground. So this also same thing, earthquake effects on structures. When the seismic waves pass through soft soil, there is more magnification of the waves. Although seismic wave may travel tens of kilometers of rock, and often less than 100 meters of soil. The soil plays very important role in determining the characteristic of ground motion. The topography, then the nature of bedrock and nature of geometry of the depositional soils are the main factors that influence local modification of seismic waves. Now, earthquakes are measured using seismograph. So this slide explains the schematically the principle. Earthquakes generate seismic waves which can be detected with a sensitive instrument which we call seismograph. And this plotting we call seismogram. This instrument is seismograph. Fundamentally, seismograph is a simple pendulum. So when the ground shakes, the base and frame of the instrument move with it, but inertia tries to keep this pendulum bob in place. So it will then appear to move relative to the shaking ground. And as it moves, it records the pendulum displacements. And this record or tracing we call seismogram. This is the principle, but we have very sophisticated instruments these days. Modern seismometers can record a wide range of seismic signals, both very small and very large. The principle of these seismographs is mentioned here. Today, seismographs or seismometers operate by measuring the amount of electrical energy needed to keep the mass centered in the housing in the presence of strong ground shaking. So this is the housing. So we have a mass here. The electrical energy required to keep this mass in the central position will indicate the amount of shaking here. So also now we have very sophisticated instruments, and digitally the earthquakes are recorded. And sitting in Delhi, like IMD, Indian Meteorological Department office in Delhi, can collect the data from all the seismographs from all over the country. So this is a typical seismogram. This is the ground shaking recorded by the seismograph. So start primary waves, P waves travel fastest and they arrive first, followed by S waves, and then we have the surface waves. So the whole this plot may last only a minute or 2 minutes, but by that time so much shaking and damage for the structures would have been reached. So this part of the shaking we call strong motion, where we have large values of displacements or accelerations, and the nature, random in nature, and their function of time and cyclic. So these are the characteristics of this strong motion. And this earthquake record, they vary from earthquake to earthquake. So we cannot have one set of plot for all the buildings design. So this is a plot of 2001 Bhuj earthquake. We have the acceleration here, acceleration. If you see, this is 140 seconds, and we have the strong motion somewhere here from 30 to 60 seconds, this region. And this is the plot of displacements. This is the record obtained in Ahmedabad, whereas the epicenter was near Bhuj. So more than 300 kilometers away, this record was taken. This slide shows the locating the shaking or the epicenter. Seismologists locate earthquakes by measuring the time between the primary waves and secondary waves in a seismogram. After a seismogram feels an earthquake, scientists compare the time difference of those waves to figure out how far away the earthquake is. For example, if this is a seismograph, here the record of the earthquake will be received like this. So, knowing the difference between difference of time between the arrival of primary waves and secondary waves, you can calculate the distance. So, earthquake has occurred, or the epicenter of the earthquake is say 2,800 kilometers from this. So, we can draw a circle like this. Another station, same principle, difference of arrival time between primary and secondary waves, say 4,800 kilometers is the distance to the epicenter. So they can draw a circle with 4,800 kilometer radius. So crossing of these two circles will indicate two points. You can see two points. So earthquake may have occurred here or here. So next, if you have the data from one more seismograph, where it says 3,400 kilometers is the distance to epicenter. So if we draw a circle here, so meeting of three circles will indicate the location of the epicenter. That is why it is mentioned here. It takes at least three seismograms to locate exactly where the earthquake is. By measuring the SP time, that is the arrival of secondary wave, primary wave times at three or more stations, these circles can be drawn around each station and where they meet indicate the location of the earthquake. We have already used the term magnitude. So this earthquake magnitude, it was proposed by Charles Francis Richter, American seismologist. It's the photo taken in 1970. It is also known as local magnitude scale, but now this Richter magnitude scale is widely used. So this estimates the amount of energy released at the source of the earthquake. For a given earthquake, only one value, one magnitude. It is a quantitative measure of the earthquake. Whereas we have the scale intensity. Intensity is a measure of the degree of earthquake shaking at a given location based on the amount of damage. There is so-called Mercalli intensity scale or modified Mercalli intensity scale. So it is a qualitative measure of the earthquake. We actually observe the damage pattern near to the epicenter and around the epicenter and at various locations. We can say what is the amount of damage, and then we say what is the intensity of that earthquake. So intensity will vary from place to place, whereas the magnitude will be one value for a given earthquake. So this earlier also we saw this, I will skip. Less than 3.5 earthquake generally felt, not felt, but recorded by the instruments. Magnitude 3.5 to 5.4 rarely causes damage. Under 6, slight damage to well-designed buildings, but can cause major damage to poorly constructed buildings. And 6 to 6.9 can be destructive in areas up to about 100 kilometers. A strong earthquake, this is a major 7 to 7.9 major earthquake and 8 or greater great earthquake. At least one earthquake of magnitude 8 occurs somewhere in the world as per the past data. Now intensity, as I mentioned, intensity shows the amount of damage, and intensity, the earthquake effect will vary greatly according to distance, ground conditions, construction standards and other factors. We should not confuse intensity with the magnitude. So intensity is an arbitrary ranking based on the observed effects. And it is a qualitative measure. As I mentioned, magnitude is quantitative measure, whereas intensity is a qualitative measure of the actual shaking. Roman capital numerals are assigned based on the amount of damage. The intensity scale varying from 1 to 12. 1 to 12. 12 is the most severe damage. Isoseismal map. The map showing this intensity we call isoseismal map. This is 2000 Bhuj earthquake, so near the epicenter, intensity 10, 9, as you move away, intensity will reduce. So earthquakes are measured either magnitude or intensity. Magnitude shows the amount of energy released and intensity shows the damage. So intensity varies from 1 to 12, 12 is the total destruction. Whereas magnitude scale is an open-end scale, magnitude 8 and great indicate the severe earthquake or the great earthquake. So this slide shows the comparison of intensity scale and the magnitude intensity, that is modified Mercalli scale or magnitude by in terms of Richter scale. So this is the intensity near to the epicenter where a lot of damage is there. So an attempt is made to compare if this is the say 4.5 is the magnitude, what would be the intensity near that region like this. Bhuj earthquake, for example, magnitude was 7.7 and we had the high intensity, maximum intensity observed was intensity 10 in Mercalli scale. Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay. This shows the seismic zoning map of India. Our country is divided into 4 seismic zones. Earlier there were 5, but zone 1 is merged with zone 2 now. So zone 2 is shown in this blue color. Seismic disturbance up to magnitude 4.9 we can expect in this location. Zone 3, a moderate earthquake risk zone, magnitude up to 6.9. So Chennai comes in zone 3. Zone 3. Mangalore, my place also in zone 3. Coastal Karnataka, Kerala comes in zone 3. So this all yellow color indicates zone 3 area. Then zone 4, high risk zone, magnitude up to 7.9. Our capital Delhi comes in zone 4. Then near here, Bombay comes in zone 3, but Koyna area comes in zone 4. Then zone 5, very high risk zone, magnitude 8 or greater, we can expect Bhuj area and parts of Kashmir, Uttarakhand, then entire northeast comes in zone 5. So about 60% of our country comes in zone 3, 4 or 5, magnitude more than 3, 4, 5. So 60% of our country comes in zone 3, 4 and 5 where we can expect earthquakes, moderate risk, moderate to very high earthquakes. So it is very much essential that we consider earthquakes in our structural designs. Seismic zoning map was revised regularly. Recent revision was in 1893-2016. Now if you look at the fatalities, earlier 1900-1949 collapse of masonry building, then there were a lot of timber buildings, so fatalities were more due to masonry and timber, not much RC reinforced concrete construction at that time. Then fire, landslide and other causes, these indicate the fatalities. But 1950 onwards we have a lot of RC buildings also. Of course, masonry in most of the developing countries all over the world, Central America, South America, Asia, we have a lot of masonry construction. So still there is a lot of fatality due to collapse of masonry buildings. Also, the contribution of RC building is increased here. Because we have a lot of RC buildings, so collapse of these buildings resulting in loss of property and lives has become more. This data is 1950 to 1999. So if you look at the present scenario, RC building percentage would be much more higher than shown here. So this is quickly about the engineering seismology. Now we will see some of the damage patterns of buildings and other structures during the first earthquakes. First we will discuss some of the Indian earthquakes and then we'll see the case studies of foreign earthquakes outside India. Typical failure patterns identified in a masonry building. It's a masonry building. Separation of roof from the wall. Separation from roof from the wall. This is Bhuj earthquake, magnitude 7.7, occurred on January 26th. So a lot of masonry buildings collapsed during this earthquake, mainly due to the development of X cracks, diagonal cracks in the walls, and also out of plane motion, out of plane motion of the walls. This is failure of junction of two orthogonal walls. So this is the junction. We have walls in two directions. So at this junction, the collapse or damage has occurred. Failure of junction of two orthogonal walls in unreinforced masonry building during 2011 Sikkim earthquake. Sikkim comes in zone 4. An earthquake of magnitude 6.9 occurred and a lot of buildings got damaged. This is Samkhiali region. Combination of in-plane and out-of-plane failure during Bhuj earthquake. You can see the development of these X cracks along these walls between the openings. And in many buildings, these separated and collapsed also. This is X cracking during Northern Iran earthquake 1990. Then this figure shows the damage of a masonry house. You can see the walls have collapsed and the roof has failed here. So this is a separation of wall at the junction at the corner. And here, buckling of voids. You can see this stone masonry wall. You can see here two layers, which we call voids. And here, this inside is actually open here. So the buckling of these walls has occurred. Our country, we have a lot of masonry building, and to improve the earthquake resistance, we have this recommendation for the provision of reinforced concrete beams or wooden beams, which we call bands. So bands at plinth level and lintel level, this will provide more integrity to the structure, and structure will behave as a single unit. This is for a two-story building with pitched roof. Here also we provide these bands at plinth level, lintel level, and so on. So this will improve the earthquake resistance. You can see the 1993 Latur earthquake, Central India. One masonry house in Kilari village had no horizontal lintel band. And you can see the collapse of the roof and walls. Another building where they had provided the lintel band, horizontal lintel band, and it withstood the earthquake safely. And this is from the 2001 Bhuj earthquake. Although a lot of masonry structures failed, some of the structures which had these kinds of bands, they performed very well. The lower building, this is a bentonite factory. There were cracks developed here, but the wall didn't collapse. And they could repair these cracks easily, and the structure was put into use. Then this is about the traditional houses, performance of traditional houses, so-called bunga houses in Kutch region. Single-story, single-room, cylindrical shape with conical roof. So this is single-story, single-room, conical roof. and they withstood the earthquake without damage. You can see they had power connection, fan, light and so on. So this is the wall here. Actually wall, you can see here also, it consists of these straws or wooden stakes reinforced with earth. Earthen wall reinforced with these wooden sticks. This is a window. So these structures, they withstood the earthquake very well. When nearby many buildings, masonry buildings had collapsed, and there was a safari lodge imitating these bunga houses. But masonry houses, roof, they have imitated like this. That is actually Rudramata reservoir is there. And this is the view from the lodge. Many of the safari lodge cottages, they developed cracks because walls were masonry walls. And there were cracks developed and some had collapsed. Damaged cottages of the Gaza Safari Lodge, Rudramata village. So while the traditional houses where you had the mud wall reinforced with sticks withstood the earthquake, whereas the masonry without any lintel band or plinth band, lot of these masonry houses had collapsed. These were taken from earthquake tips. We have the lecture in the afternoon by Professor C.V.R. Murthy, who is the author of Earthquake Tips, give a lot of information about the earthquake mechanism and the performance of masonry and RC buildings. I hope many of you have gone through these tapes. So these, many of my slides have been, photographs have been taken from these earthquake tips, IIT Kanpur. Building Materials Technology Promotion Council jointly funded this earthquake tips, and we can download this from this website, NICE, National Information Center for Earthquake Engineering. So effect of inertia in a building when shaken is shown here. So base moves, the top portion tries to remain in its original position. So this introduces inertia force in the building. Inertia force and relative motion with respect to building. So this is the original position of the columns. So displaced position. So base moves, whereas the top tries to remain in the original position. So we have the inertia force opposing the motion. So earthquake mainly induces inertia force. So mass into acceleration will give inertia force. Lower the mass, inertia force will be less, or smaller the acceleration, inertia force will be less. So it is recommended that we construct the buildings with to be lighter to withstand the earthquakes. Whatever inertia forces develop should be transferred through the walls and columns to the foundations and ultimately to the mother earth. This right hand side shows the earthquake damage. Partial collapse of stone masonry walls during the Uttarakashi earthquake, which happened in 1991. And here, this is collapse of the RC columns and building. This is 2001 Bhuj earthquake. Then out of plane collapse of peripheral walls, Bhuj earthquake, wall flexure. Can see here, and here out of plane failure of walls. This is 2015 Nepal earthquake. So the walls have failed. Earthquake shaking may be in this direction. So perpendicular to the earthquake shaking direction, there has been collapse of the walls. Following typical damages. We can identify in a masonry building. Cracks between walls and floor. We have seen some damages due to these effects. Cracks at corners and at wall intersections. Out of plane collapse of perimeter walls. Diagonal cracks in structural walls. partial disintegration or collapse of walls, partial or complete collapse of the building. So if this is a direction of seismic action, we have the development of these X cracks, shear cracks, and also out of plane bending you can see of these walls, collapse of also separation here happening near the wall junction, wall intersections. Some of the damage photographs. This is 2016 Manipur earthquake. Magnitude 6.7. Focal depth was around 57 kilometers. So damage to the walls, wall corners. Here a RC building has failed here. This is a damage in a church. The roof has collapsed. This is a soft story collapse. The ground story in India, it is very common practice for parking purposes. We have open space, and if we don't provide sufficient stiffness to the columns, then that story will be like a soft story, and this will result when subjected to strong shaking, this story is affected. You can see here. This is the position. So these columns, water tank columns were resting here. I think this is water tank. Yeah. So this ground story has been crushed here. So this portion has come down. Soft story collapse of the right wing of the building. The left wing without soft story. You can see here walls. So this is without soft story. Is apparently undamaged. Right hand side. This is mid story collapse. In Kobe earthquake, 1995 Kobe earthquake. So maybe at this level they had an open story, maybe for some conference or conference hall or something. So that story has been crushed. So this shows the schematic diagram here. Open ground story buildings with masonry infills only in the upper stories, this one. So we have masonry infills upper story. Ground story open. So we have large or severe deformation demand at the ground story column. So the ground story columns are subjected to large deformations. If we don't consider masonry and if we do the analysis, this is the shape, bare frame. However, due to masonry effects, we have large deformation at the ground story columns compared to other columns. So this ground story is crushed. So that's what is happening here. This is Gandhidham Sayaji Hotel. So it failed in the soft ground story. And you can see that the ground story has been crushed here. This is a closer view. Sayaji Hotel at Gandhidham failed at the ground story. Ground story columns you can see. Say, many buildings failed due to the soft story effects or open ground story effects. Another building, collapse of apartment building in Ahmedabad. Again, we have this open ground story failure. So it's common mode of failure when subjected to horizontal shaking. So we need to design these columns for higher forces compared to upper story columns. Sometimes, RC elevator core provided in the building may prevent the total collapse by you can see here RC elevator core provides considerable lateral stiffness and strength. So cracks have been developed, but it has prevented the collapse of the ground story. This building, inadequate anchorage into stiff RC elevator core walls. So we have the reinforced concrete walls for this lift or elevator, but not properly connected to building all around. So could not make use of the advantage of this core walls. It is a photo taken in Gandhidham. Again, Bhuj earthquake, short column effect. you can see these are the columns, and we have the masonry walls built up to partial height. So this results in this portion attracting large shear forces. So you have these kinds of cracks developing, shear cracks developing and failure. Here also you can see this is damage to buildings. Manipur earthquake, X cracks have developed in the walls, and here those walls have failed. So bare frame, in the case of bare frame, it is predominantly frame action. We have the bending also, whereas when there is infill, there are predominantly shear action. So when the shaking will be left to right and right to left, alternate, because it is cyclic in nature. So we have compression and tension along the diagonal. So once when there is compression along this diagonal, other diagonal we have tension. So repeatedly compression and tension occurs along the both diagonal, and then ultimately we have these kinds of cracks being developed. Another case of failure of the weak concrete. Failure of the weak concrete in the topi just below the beam. You can see this portion. When we do the concreting, normally we do the concreting for the columns up to certain height, and top portion of the columns, and which we call topi, 100 to 200 mm depth here. So concreting of this as well as concreting of this beam is always done together. Concrete in beam and topi is done together. Flow of concrete through bottom beam bars becomes difficult because we have reinforcement here. Flow of concrete becomes difficult. And if the compaction is not done properly, honeycombed concrete occurs, honeycombing. And this is very dangerous. And when subjected to earthquake, shaking, you can see these kinds of failure. This is Bhuj earthquake damage. Here also crushing and spalling of concrete close to the beam bottom. So this may be attributed to honeycombing, formation of honeycombing, no proper compaction during construction. Although we do very well, very good designs, if the there is lacuna in construction stage, then these kinds of failure can occur. This shows shear cracking of non-ductile columns of an open ground story building, 2001 Bhuj earthquake. And you can see the spacing of stirrups is not sufficient. This is pencil, ball pen there. You can see the spacing is more than 150 mm, this stirrup. So no proper confinement of concrete. And you have here shear cracks being developed. Also, as per the code, we have to give this 135 degree hooks. For stirrups, it should be 135 degree hooks. But in India, normally we give 90 degree hooks. And 90 degree hooks are not enough to prevent the earthquake-induced pulling of this reinforcement. So we can expect these kinds of damage. So it is highly recommended that we follow the code and we provide these 135 degree hooks. And when the dimension is large, we have to provide a cross tie also. If it is more than 300 mm, if the dimension of the column or beam, we need to provide a cross tie in between. And right hand side building, we don't see any stirrups at all. Unfortunately, no stirrups at all. We just went through. This is also damage pattern from Bhuj earthquake. Damaged school building in Kukuma village. Walls have failed, and we didn't see any reinforcement here. No lintel band here. also the anchorage at the beam column joints, if you see, simply the reinforcement has come out. As per the code, IS 13920, if you see, there is a guidance requirement of anchorage of reinforcement, anchorage of beam in an external joint. The reinforcement should go development length plus 10 times the beam diameter, 10 times DB. So if sufficient anchorage is not provided, reinforcement will simply come out. This is also a Bhuj earthquake. This is collapse of a high-rise building, Mansi complex. This is the diagram of this view, this building. This one part of this building has collapsed. We have the elevator here. This is the stiff side. This is the soft part. This has collapsed. Mansi complex collapsed due to overload from fuel at the top. So this is the standing portion. If you look at this position of the swimming pool, it was provided on one side, and it is said that it was not there in the original design. So they have provided a swimming pool at the penthouse at the top. So center of mass, it has not coincided with center of rotation or center of stiffness. So this has resulted in twisting or torsion. And because of this, this portion has collapsed. And while it fell down, it has moved, it has damaged the adjacent building also. Direction of movement of building just before collapse, and adjacent building that was damaged. So in it is in earthquake resistant design, it is recommended that we provide as much regular building design as much as possible. Shape should be regular, so that the distance between center of rotation and center of mass is minimal. So this can avoid torsional effect. If the swimming pool is there in the original design, so then care must have been taken. But because it was provided afterwards, not there in the original design, so it resulted in the failure of that building. Now this shows the damaged residence in Anjar village. It was not occupied. Building was under construction only, construction stage. But in, during this earthquake, lot of damage occurred due to, for the beams and columns. You can see here, failure, cracks, shear failure of the columns and so on. This is Kandla Port, near Kandla Port, RC warehouse. There were damages to the peripheral columns. This also may be due to the short column effect. Not sufficient stirrups, lateral ties provided here. Inside columns performed well. Only columns periphery, you have this masonry, these walls built to certain heights. So they attracted large shear forces and got damaged. This is damage to industrial structures, product manufacturing unit of RC. There were damage to infills. Infills have fallen here. This is motor fuel storage tank, slid off its foundation. Extensive damage to inlet outlet pipings occurred. And this is pipe flange of naphtha storage tank ruptured. Damage was here. You can see that pipe flange has failed, ruptured. This is liquefaction effects. I was involved in the earthquake damage survey team during Bhuj earthquake. So a lot of photographs taken by me only. This is Kandla Fort. Ground settlement occurred due to liquefaction. Sorry. okay, here the ground settlement. Building was not damaged, so simply they built one more step and building was under use. Here sand boiling, and here telephone pole. Many telephone and electrical poles collapsed during this earthquake because of liquefaction. Liquefaction means soil losing its shear strength. Okay, this is just, I thought I will indicate. This is 2001 Bhuj earthquake damage survey team. Now 2021, so 20 years back. I was part of that time. I was in Japan, so part of Japan team. And these are all professors from IIT, IIT Roorkee. This is Professor Paul. He expired recently. Professor Paul, Professor Ashwini Kumar. Then this is Professor from Tokyo University, Professor Meguro, one of the leading earthquake engineer now. Professor Meguro, and there are few more Indians and some Japanese researchers. This is me. Now I will show some example of earthquakes from abroad. Earlier we discussed the global earthquakes, so some typical earthquakes I will discuss. This is Chichi earthquake in Taiwan. Some of these earthquakes data was collected from our master course students. I had given them a mini project of collection of data, and they have provided this information. This earthquake occurred in September 21, 1999. Epicenter located 150 kilometers south of Taipei. Focus is 8 kilometers below surface. Very shallow earthquake, magnitude 7.3. Vertical displacements reaching about 7 meters were observed. 2,400 people died, and main shock accompanied by more than 10,000 aftershocks. So, lot of aftershocks in this earthquake. And peak ground acceleration were observed approximately 1G to 1.2G. G is acceleration due to gravity. So, 9.8 meters per second square, 1G means. Very severe earthquake. And some damage patterns are shown here. Damage to buildings. This is a commercial building. Commercial buildings with soft story at the bottom, and complete collapse was observed when the buildings were close to the fault lines. So failure of the building due to soft story. And here damage to bridges, roadways and railways. Movement of embankment behind bridge abutments, and landslides destroying roads. You can see roads were damaged. During an earthquake, it is very much essential that the infrastructure like roads, railways, hospitals function. So they have to be designed for a higher earthquakes. This is dam, Shi Kong Dam collapse, suffered partial collapse of a buttress and the bridge deck at the mid crest area. If you look at the structural damage, failure of columns and walls, you can see here, compression failure of column, exposing reinforcement at the base. And this shows the left column is embedded in lintel beam. So this left column, it is embedded in lintel beam, whereas the right column is independent and undergoing local buckling. Although columns are so close, the damage pattern looked slightly different. And right hand side, we have the upper portion of the building undergone 90 degree rotation and crashed it into the ground. So this entire building has fallen. Happened due to the crushing of columns on one side of the ground story. Then this shows the shear cracks on the walls in the form of 45 degree X cracking. Here also building crushed here. Here you can see cracks in the columns, shear cracking in the columns. failure of beams and slabs. Column failure led to slabs collapsing onto the ground. No serious cracks were found on slabs, whereas shear cracks on beams due to the lack of stirrups. Then failure of beam column system. Concrete cores were taken from the collapsed 12-story building and they were tested. It was found that the average strength of concrete used for beams and columns were 12.5 MPa and 18.2 MPa. Whereas the required strength was 27.5 MPa. So average strengths actually provided were very much lower than the required strength. And steel samples were tested. Design yield stress value was 412 MPa, whereas for the beams, it was found around 470 MPa, and for the columns, 413 MPa. So low strength of concrete and high yield strength of reinforcement, it provided a strong beam, weak column designs. We have to design such that columns are stronger than beams, so failure will be local. Local and the structure won't collapse as a whole. Then there was in this building absence of quality control was observed in many buildings. Use of more than 20% fly ash in ready mix concrete, aggregates of improper size and gradation. Sorry, use of underground sand contaminated with clay and organic matter. And also using or adding excessive water to increase workability and to reduce labor hours. So such kind of improper quality control was observed. And tension test on rebar from the damaged building showed very small elongation and very little necking, indicating low ductility. And corrosion was also observed in the reinforcement. Corrosion also observed in the reinforcement of slabs, which may be attributed to thin concrete cover or use of sea sand. So extensive corrosion was observed. Continuation of structural damages. Inappropriate construction practices. We know that reinforcement should not be curtailed. Building code required not more than 50% of the reinforcement to overlap at a single section. But many columns failed at sections where 100% of the rebar overlap took place. Then lack of provision of 135 degree hooks. And then hoop spacing was not enough. So if the hoop spacing, spacing of ties is larger, that will result in less shear strength. That was about Chichi earthquake of Taiwan. Now, Valdivia earthquake in 1960, this is the strongest earthquake recorded so far. Chile, magnitude was 9.5, focal depth 33 kilometers. And so this is America, North America, South America. So Chile here, southern part of, southwestern part of South America. So this is the Pacific plate, Pacific plate. So all around this is the active region. The failure mainly due to soil conditions. The city is underlain by interlayer sands and silts having moderate to high plasticity. And the surface topography of the city has been modified over time. Low spots filled by low and high plastic silts experience ground failure. Sorry. So you can see photographs of the fissures in the ground, mainly due to liquefaction and lateral spreading. And lot of failure of masonry buildings, mainly unreinforced masonry structure. And here failure of reinforced concrete bridge deck and damage caused by a subsidence. It is Chile earthquake 1960. Now Mexico earthquake 1985. Mexico earthquake, the epicenter was very far from the Mexico City. So this is the epicenter. As you know, Mexico is located south of USA, Central America, and a lot of damage occurred here because of the magnification of seismic waves. It occurred in 1985, magnitude 8.1. This I will skip. Mexico City area was 350 kilometer away from the epicenter, but still it caused widespread damage in the city. If a seismic wave were traveling through uniform material, ground shaking would be half a strong at 13 kilometer, 1/4 strong at 27, 1/8 strong as 50 kilometer. For example, if this is the epicenter, this is the shaking at 13 kilometers, 27, 50, we would have expected this much lesser shaking. However, if you look at the Mexico City, the Mexico City was located in reclaimed land. Earlier it was a lake. So the soil conditions are very soft, very soft. So Mexico City is a sediment filled basin surrounded by hard volcanic bedrock mountains. As waves progress and move towards the softer bed, basin amplification occurs. That is having low frequency and high amplitude. And this has shaken the sediments of the ground like a jelly in a bowl. So this is high frequency, low amplitude. And when the this part of the city, we have low frequency and high amplitude shaking. And the buildings, if you look at the buildings, small buildings have short natural period, and very tall buildings, long periods, and medium buildings, we have medium natural periods, around 2 seconds. And during this earthquake, buildings around these natural periods, buildings with natural, these natural periods got damaged. In Mexico City earthquake, as the ground was oscillating at 2 second time period, the building of 8 to 20 stories with similar natural period suffered the most damage. So you can see the damage pattern here, RC building. Most of the earthquake damage was to the buildings. Two reasons are the resonance in the lake bed sediments and the long duration of the shaking. So in some areas, collision of building, what we call pounding effect, the damage occurred. And in some cases, the foundation experienced damage, such as pile driven into the clay, which was held in place by friction. Pile was not up to the hard ground, but in between stopped, and resistance was provided by friction, and it turned out to be weak when subjected to shaking. So a lot of damage occurred in Mexico City, although it was located more than 300 kilometers away from the epicenter. Then we have the 1971 San Fernando, California earthquake occurred in 1971, and hypocenter was 12.87 kilometers deep, focus depth. So it is a shallow earthquake only. And in this case, a dam got damaged. A dam was affected. So some of the photographs of damage. This is damage to the column, second story column fracture in the hospital. This is the Olive View Hospital. It's a collapse, first story of psychiatric building in this hospital. This is a fractured column of freeway overpass. damaged section of freeway overpass, you can see. Maybe ground conditions at these locations resulted in this kind of failure. Damaged steel reinforcement support for the freeway overpass. And this is failure of San Diego freeway overpass. This earthquake reinforced the need for bridge engine designers to consider strong ground shaking as well as the ground failure effects. So when we design, we need to consider the ground conditions, ground failure effects also. So this was reinforced during this earthquake. Then this is damage to electrical power stations. And this is the aerial view of collapsed section of the dam, Norman Dam. It can cause secondary failure, the flooding of downstream. So a lot of people had to be evacuated. This is from the 1994 Northridge earthquake, again USA. Normally we think that steel structures are safe during earthquakes. However, failure of the foundation here resulted in the collapse of these lattice towers, transmission line towers. This is the first time that an earthquake caused the collapse of lattice type transmission towers. This 66 kilowatt tower located on a ridge crest collapsed because of differential foundation movement. All six conductors that the tower was carrying snapped, bringing down the adjacent towers. So this tower was supported on the foundations, and because of the differential settlement or movement of the foundations, collapse occurred. And when it failed, it brought down the adjacent towers also because of the snapping of the cables. This is from the 2010 Haiti earthquake in Central America. Magnitude was not much, magnitude severe only, but 7. It was 7, but deaths, if you look, it is very high. Haiti 80% below poverty line, 80% of the people are below poverty line. So we have poor housing conditions, masonry houses, they collapsed. This photograph, administrative building collapse, and also here damage to a church. Some of the photographs here show very poor gradation of reinforcement of the concrete here, and can see all this poor aggregate shape and grading, poorly located construction joints, formwork embedded in finished concrete, debris left in joints, segregation, voids, honeycombing. These are some of the causes. Very poor construction. So this resulted in a lot of damage to buildings and loss of lives. X cracking of the walls, localized damage, column shear failure, toppling and out of plane wall failures. I think I will take another 10 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes. This is 1964 Niigata earthquake. You can see here buildings tilted up to 60 degrees. Some of the four-story buildings in the Kawangi Shichijo apartment complex settled and tipped as much as 60 degrees. This is magnitude 7.3 earthquake. Loss of bearing strength was caused by liquefaction of a sand layer 10 to 15 feet, that is 3 to 5 meters, below the base of the affected buildings. The peak ground acceleration did not exceed 0.1 g in the earthquake. So peak ground acceleration was not much, but there was liquefaction of sand layer below these buildings, so which resulted in the tilting collapse of the building. It is said that people came out of these buildings through these windows. Because of this earthquake, after this Niigata earthquake, people realized, designers, the researchers realized the importance of liquefaction, and geotechnical earthquake engineering became a major field of study. Then this is again Japan, 2011 Tohoku earthquake. Earlier I showed Niigata earthquake, So Niigata earthquake, Niigata is in around this area. And this is Tohoku earthquake. This is Tohoku region, Miyagi prefecture. The earthquake occurred on 11th March, magnitude 9, one of the very severe earthquake. So there was structural damage as well as damage to nuclear reactors. At a magnitude of 9, it was the largest recorded in Japan since modern seismograms became available. Huge physical damage and loss of life. Total deaths were 19,729, in addition to 2,559 people missing. And caused a severe accident at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant, which was the second worst nuclear catastrophe after Chernobyl disaster in Russia. Damages to structures, damage of base isolated building due to long duration of ground motion. This is a hotel building with damaged base isolation device and damaged lead damper overview. Lead damper as base isolation device. During this huge earthquake with long duration, building structures were shaken by a huge number of displacement cycles. And in this particular building, the lead dampers were damaged and were subsequently replaced. The damage of the base isolation devices was mainly due to repeated number of displacement cycles and the accumulated displacements to the structures. This is building damage due to site-specific ground motion amplification in Aobayama Hill in Sendai, Sendai city. So this is actually Department of Civil Engineering building. 9-story building housing the departments of civil engineering and architecture in the Faculty of Engineering at Tohoku University. damage. Tohoku University is one of the top universities in Japan, which they call Imperial University, one of the oldest universities located in Sendai. So here, the building, this building, civil engineering department building, constructed in 1969, and it was seismically retrofitted after the 1978 Miyagi earthquake. The building was on a hill slope site and has a foundation with RC cross piles of length 12 meters. And in this building, long-term monitoring of dynamic characteristics has been performed by instruments for 40 or so years since the building was completed. So it was an instrumented building. And this building was heavily damaged at the bottom four corner columns. You can see here. At the four corner columns, the damage was there. You can see here, this is the damaged portion of the columns. The severe crack in the side shear wall was possibly due to partial uplifting at the level of third floor. So we can see windows here. At these ends, we have this shear wall. Almost all multi-story buildings in Japan, they provide shear walls, and even this shear wall got damaged during this earthquake. And these are examples of damage to other buildings. Damage to a non-structural wall, X-crack damage, shear crack. You can see here, structural beam. There is a damage. Inclined four-story RC pile foundation building. This building, subsided bottom part of the southeast corner of column. Southeast corner of column. Here subsidence has taken place, and uplifting of the foundation in the north side. So north side uplifting, whereas southeast corner column there is subsidence. Non-structural damage in earthquake tips, there is a tip entirely devoted to the consideration of non-structural elements in buildings. This is the damage features of fallen ceiling boards at a cultural hall in Sendai city. So large open space, and the structure was not damaged, but non-structural parts, the ceiling boards, they failed. Investigations based on micro tremor observations at this hall showed that the collapse of the ceiling appears to have been due to lack of strength in the vertical motion, and the unexpected collision between hanging boards and equipment such as air conditioning ducts. So consideration of non-structural elements such as false ceiling is also important. Then during this earthquake, there was tsunami. Tohoku earthquake caused extensive tsunami. I don't have the video of tsunami. You can get on net. Some of you might have seen. So it resulted in failure of buildings, concrete wall failure due to the internal pressurization, and uplifted and overturning of a two-story RC building. This is the bottom portion of the building you are seeing here. Fish market building damage. It's all damage due to tsunami. So buildings which withstood the earthquake, they got damage during this tsunami action. Then, as I mentioned, the nuclear reactors got damaged during this earthquake. The earthquake caused shutdowns and other electrical grid supply problems. The reactors' electricity supplies failed, and their emergency diesel generators automatically started. So during earthquake, there was electrical power grid problem. So emergency diesel generators automatically started. So they provided the power. But when tsunamis arrived at this location, they flooded these diesel generators. So it resulted in loss of power to the pumps of the nuclear facilities. The resultant loss of reactor core cooling led to nuclear meltdowns, hydrogen explosions, and the release of radioactive contamination between 12th March and 15th March. So there was radioactive contamination. And there have been no deaths or cases of radiation sickness from the nuclear accident, but over 1 lakh people were evacuated from their homes as a preventive measure. So this is damaged buildings at Fukushima nuclear power plant. So these structures were designed to withstand the earthquake and also tsunami up to certain height, but the tsunamis generated during this earthquake, their height far exceeded for which these facilities were designed, and that resulted in flooding of the diesel generators and subsequent failure of these facilities and nuclear radiation. Still, these are not under use. Still, they are dealing with this catastrophe. Now, Nepal earthquake, it magnitude 7.8. Epicenter near Kathmandu here, and this is the areas of shaking, India portion of India and also in Nepal. Some of the damage pattern, fissures in the walls, collapse of the masonry structures, and collapse of even RC buildings. Then this is 2018 Sulawesi recent earthquake. This is in Indonesia. This is Sulawesi Island. magnitude 7.5 and focal depth was 20 kilometers. This is the epicenter of the earthquake. And nearby cities, Palu city, a lot of damage occurred. These colors actually indicate the intensity, earthquake intensity distribution. And this location, the locality had three general type of low-rise buildings here, steel timber houses, timber frame with the mortar infill, and then confined masonry houses. All these kinds of buildings got damaged during this earthquake. So masonry school building brought down by earthquake, out of length failure of a timber frame structure, and here masonry wall damage due to insufficient confinement. And here large ground displacement, you can see a large ground displacement, it led to damage to the roads. And this resulted in tsunami also. Most buildings in Palu and Donggala region were low-rise buildings. Stilt houses were mainly timber constructions, raised on top of piles with concrete foundation. And in central Sulawesi, these houses were built either on land or in the body of bay water. These houses proved to be remarkably resistant to earthquake. These stilt houses, timber construction houses, they were remarkably resistant to earthquake, standing unharmed in areas unaffected by tsunami. However, in tsunami affected region, these houses were mostly wiped out. So this is the recent earthquake in Indonesia. Then a few more photographs. I think 5 minutes I will finish. 1988 Armenia earthquake. So unreinforced masonry building. You can see a very high damage. Earthquake magnitude was 6.8 only. A lot of buildings were damaged. This is 1992 Turkey earthquake. Severely damaged, nearly collapsed residential building. We can see column shear, joint shear, lack of beam anchorage, bar anchorage to the concrete frame structures, almost all kinds of failure patterns in this building. Then Kobe earthquake, 1995. It is also one of the strong earthquakes. A lot of damage was caused by fire. Early morning, this earthquake occurred. People were preparing for breakfast. So you can see fires burning here. This is expressway. This is the canal here. Piers yielded near the canal, maybe due to soft soil conditions. So failure of this expressway. spans fallen off supporting from supporting piers. Here this is a bus filled with tourists. When the earthquake happened and shaking started, the driver applied brakes and just saved. This is elevated expressway. You can see collapse of this elevated expressway. This is a closer view. So failure of this piers. That is Kobe earthquake. This also Kobe earthquake. Railway damage. Lot of railway tracks were damaged and railway bogies collapsed, failed in this earthquake. And porcelain failure in a substation. In Bangalore, we have Central Power Research Institute where they have a shake table and they test the strength of these porcelain fittings, electrical substation components for earthquake shaking. And this is also very important because during any earthquake, the restoration of power supply is one of the very important requirements. This is Costa Rica earthquake. Costa Rica is in Central America. A lot of liquefaction and ground spreading occurred. You can see the depth of these cracks in the east-west highway. liquefaction and lateral spreading induced fissures in the main east-west highway between Sequeiras and Puerto Limon. Puerto Limon here and Sequeiras, this northwest east-west highway became heavily damaged during this earthquake. This is 1964 Alaska earthquake, magnitude 9.2. So far, the Chile earthquake, magnitude 9.5, and then this 1964 Alaska earthquake, second greatest recorded earthquake. Lateral spreads cause distortion of railroad tracks. You can see here, distortion of railroad tracks in this Alaska earthquake. And in this case, in the right-hand side, you can see steel truss railway bridge. Here, the lateral spreading of the banks destroyed the foundation of the supporting structure, allowing it to drop onto the banks. So this is the Alaska earthquake. Okay. I think this is the last slide. So this is, okay, this is NITK beach, or NITK, or institute is somewhere here. We have a beach gate here, and we have a sand beach, and a lighthouse, nearby lighthouse. Some of you might have seen, I invite, when the COVID situation improves, wherever possible, I invite you to visit our university and enjoy the campus and our beach. Thank you for the attention.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor. Yeah, thank you very much, Professor, for your exhaustive lecture. In fact, you are lecturing.
The initial problems. Net
okay,
connection
no.
problems.
Yeah. Yeah, no issues, Professor. It was a complete lecture on the experiences from the past earthquakes and engineering seismology as well. So, participants, if you have any questions, you can just unmute your mic and you can raise your questions, Professor Katta Venkatramana.
Any questions?
Hello, good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Sir, please explain something about the recent experiment about the prediction of earthquake. Because, sir, every time we know that it comes suddenly and there is no prediction. So please say something about what is the research going on towards this.
Research is going on towards measuring the micro tremors. And based on that data, trying to identify. And another is micro zonation. In India also, it has been started, trying to carry out micro zonation and understand the seismicity of the region. But still, it is long way. But in some countries like Japan, they are trying to estimate or get a prediction of earthquake at least few minutes or several seconds before the main event, so that they can stop like nuclear reactors or rails, railways and so on. But still it is a long way to go, prediction of earthquakes. Only as civil engineers we can try to improve the earthquake resistant features of our buildings and our structures, infrastructures.
Thank you,
sir. Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, yes.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. Sir, I have a doubt regarding the dampers in construction, sir. How effective the dampers are used in India, sir, for construction of buildings?
No, dampers, you mean to say base isolation?
Yes, sir.
Either providing base isolation or providing dampers in buildings, like diagonal bracings, dampers providing bracings, etc. They are very good at absorbing the seismic energy. Base isolation will try to prevent the transfer of vibration from the ground to the structure, whereas dampers will try to absorb energy and decrease the shaking of the building. It is good only. Slowly it is picking up in India. In India, in Bhuj Hospital, after any hospital in Bhuj, after the Bhuj earthquake, they have constructed a hospital by providing these base isolators. And it's working well. And in IIT Guwahati also, there are two buildings, adjacent buildings, one without base isolation and another with the base isolation. Instrumented building, they are recording, they are showing how base isolation can reduce the earthquake effects on the building.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. And one more thing, sir. Can we use dampers for all the buildings, sir? Like now, at present, the soil stability is very comparatively less, right? When compared to the 80s or 50 years before the construction, now the construction, the soil stability is very less. So is it essential to use dampers in all the type of structures, or how it is, sir? For
So we can use some sand layers also. Some research is going on, which is very cost effective way of providing base isolation, providing sand layers below the building. I think those topics will be discussed by the by other presenters.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir.
Today afternoon, I think Professor CVR Murthy is giving a lecture. So maybe some of these design aspects can be addressed to him also. With wide experience, I think he'll be able to give good advice.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Any other question?
Hello, sir. My name is Raja.
Hello. Yes, yes, yes.
Sir, talking about base isolation, there are many rubber-based, plastic-based isolation dampers are available. But how far the durability concerns, sir? Because there's a lot of load. We all know live load, dead load is the most load in a building. So how much it is effective, sir?
No, that has to be designed. Base isolators have to be designed considering the load coming onto them. And like lead rubber bearing, then alternate layers of steel and rubber. There are various kinds of these isolators. They have to be designed for the expected load, and we can provide it. That is not an issue.
Yes, sir. How would the durability, sir? On cyclic loading, how will the rubber will perform, sir?
No, it will, yeah, it is good only. It will deform under loading and then come back to the original position when the load is removed, when the earthquake stops. I think durability is not an issue here. Cost may be the issue.
Thank you, sir.
Any more questions? Okay, I think we can conclude for this session. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for this lecture. And so a lot of pictures from real scenario, and it was very easily understandable. And thanks for clearing all the doubts of the participants. Thanks you once again.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity. All the best. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Professor.
Thanks to all the participants for attending this lecture.